As the first part of verification, let's check if the boundary, the behavior of the CFD solution at the boundary matches the boundary conditions that we have for our problem. And if I go to the previous slide listing the boundary conditions, you can see that, for instance, at the inlet, the axial velocity, and this is the Reynolds average axial velocity, has to be equal to the value that we specified, and similarly the temperature and also the radial velocity has to be zero. So let me show you how to check that. If I go into the post-processor, and I'll do this using the probe feature, and it's and let me actually, I was playing around with it. Let me dismiss the probe. The probe feature works on unscaled geometries I found. So what I'll do is I'll go back to my temperature contours here, right click, and say duplicate. And let me say these, let me call it temperature contours unscaled or unstretched. Okay. And then let me turn off the scaled one and double click on temperature contours unscaled. Okay. And make sure I'm editing temperature contours unscaled because that's something you can trip up on. And go into view, turn off the stretching in the radial direction, and turn off the reflection and say apply. Okay, so this shows me the long narrow pipe in the original aspect ratio. And if I go near the inlet, I'll zoom in near the inlet using the right mouse button, and I'll click on probe. Okay, and let me pick a point. So I can click near the inlet and I'll go to velocity U. And you might not find this, you'll have to go into other velocity U. And there you see that value matches what we gave for the boundary condition. So for the boundary condition, this is should be equal to the, so this is 30, that's what we give, 30.06 meters per second. Similarly, you can check the temperature and all the other values, this isothermal temperature, pressure, and so on. And you can create a table of expected value at the boundary and the value at the boundary from the CFD solution as in your report, for instance. And what about the heat flux at the wall? Does that match what we gave it? Let me check that. So I'll go back here and let me go into, so I'll zoom out. In fact, if I click on Z, it'll zoom out to the entire geometry and then I'll zoom in near the heated section. Okay, so that's where heat is being added. So I'll zoom in quite a bit and then I will change this to wall heat flux. And then click on the wall. And here I see that it's almost 5,200. It doesn't match exactly what we gave it, because what we gave it was our input, or what is expected is 5,210.85 watts per meter squared. The difference is minor, and I think the difference might be because the post-processor is interpolating, the temperature values and differentiating it in a different way than the solver. So if I go into the solver in over here and interrogate that, I think I should get an exact match. But I'm not going to sweat it because it's pretty close and attribute to the difference in how the post-processor is doing the interpolation versus the solver. Okay, so that's that shows you, how you can do a quick check on the boundary conditions. And if I go back to my slide, okay, so we've looked at the boundary conditions. One more thing to do with the boundary conditions is to look at the K and epsilon. And these are guess values, right? So ideally, what one would have to do is change this and make sure that the solution doesn't change. So I would go into the solver and I would go into boundary conditions, okay? In inlet boundary conditions, if I double click it, and I would change this to say 10, so that's, more turbulent, turbulence coming in, and then I would change the turbulent viscosity ratio, which is the ratio of the turbulent viscosity to the molecular viscosity mu. And the turbulent viscosity is a derived quantity. Don't worry about what it means, but you can get K and epsilon from that. And then rerun it and check how your solution has changed. And you'll find that the turbulence gets dissipated very quickly, and most of the turbulence is going to be generated over here. So I'm not going to do that, but that's, if you're doing this in the real world, that's something I would highly recommend that you do. Going back to my checks, okay? So I talked about how to check boundary conditions and the material properties and coordinate system. There's a quick way to check that. So I'll go into the solver. And if I go to reports, okay, if I expand reports and double click on fluxes, okay, and select mass flow rate at the inlet, it'll report the mass flow rate. Now I can check that versus, the expected mass flow rate is rho at the inlet, VZ at the inlet. So that again, we gave it as a boundary condition. And the area. And the area is tricky because this is axisymmetric, cylindrical coordinate system. So the area, the actual area corresponding to that boundary is pi r squared, because you have to take this and revolve it 360 degrees about the axis to get the full area. And of course, the solution doesn't change as I irrespective of how much I revolve it. And this one I can get from P average over R T N. And I did do this check, so you should definitely do this check and compare it to this value. And you will get slightly lower values, and that's because over here, for that cell, fluent over that cell, the velocity is not VZ in, it goes from VZ into zero because, at the corner over here, the velocity is zero. So, but you'll get a very close match. And that's in fact both a check on the material property of rho, only one particular material property, and then also on the coordinate system because if it is using 2D, you won't get that right value that you expect because the area will not be the right value. So that shows you how to do some checks on whether the results are consistent with the mathematical model. Another key set of checks is whether conservation of mass, momentum, and energy are being honored. So I'll talk about that next.